Hi, this is Bill Frank reporting for KADY-TV from the Ventura County Economic Development Association Business and Education, a Partnership for the Future Symposium. Today is Wednesday, November the 7th. This symposium brings together business leaders as well as educators to discuss tighter integration between the business community and the education community. Moderator Stacy Roscoe is a lifetime VECTA board member. He'll guide the panelists through the discussion. The panelists representing educators are Stan Mantooth, who is the superintendent of Ventura County Schools, Dr. Dick Rush, who is the president of Cal State University at Channel Islands, Jamila Moore, who is the chancellor of the Ventura County Community College District, and Chris Kimball, president of Cal Lutheran University. Representing business are Bill Pratt, who's the vice president of operations at KineMed, Henny Dubroff, who is the publisher of the Pacific Coast Business Times, Bill Camarillo, the CEO of Agrimen, and Gary Wild, the president and CEO of Community Memorial Health Systems. Central to today's discussion will be the outcomes of California Propositions 30 and 38. Proposition 30 narrowly passed, providing an additional $6 billion tax dollars in revenue from a temporary sales tax increase and additional income taxes on California's wealthiest citizens to stave off additional cuts to education. California right now is spending about $9,124 per student, which is only 95% of the national average. The Proposition 38 was soundly defeated yesterday, so prospects for a voucher school system and additional funds for the school went down with that proposition. Locally in Ventura, Measure Q passed, providing an additional $59 per parcel of property to help support our schools. Today at the symposium, we hope to learn what else is necessary to fix education in Ventura County besides money. Also on the agenda today is soliciting comments from a video clip by Seth Godin for TEDx Youth at BFS. It's titled, Stop Stealing Our Dreams, What is School For? It's a thought-provoking video about changing the paradigm of education for the 21st century. It'll be informative to learn each panelist's thoughts on this video. Katie reached out to Seth Godin for his thoughts on today's symposium. In a written response, he replied he was teeing up the questions for others to answer at today's symposium. The desired result of today's symposium is a business education partnership. Notably absent from the discussion is government, so we'll want to pay attention to what the partners say the role of government is and will be. Also something to pay attention to is the high cost of higher education. The inflation rate for a college education since 1986 is 498%. That's five times faster than the overall rate of inflation. That inflation rate is higher than oil, and it's also higher than healthcare. It's projected that the cost of attending a state college will soar to $120,000 per year by the year 2015. Student debt is the fastest growing crisis in the United States. It's currently at $40 billion. The average student graduates with $27,000 of student debt, so it's critical for businesses to assess whether college education is necessary to succeed in today's environment. Educators also need to assess two things. Why are the costs rising so fast and what can be done to slow them down? And is it fair to nearly every student has a college education? Stay tuned for KDTV for complete coverage of the entire event, plus wrap-up, analysis, and interviews with the participants. I'm Bill Frank for KADY-TV.
Boy, what a quiet room. Good morning. And happy day after Election Day. Yeah, you can applaud if you want to. Some people want to and some people don't. But I guess we can say that it's over, or it's almost over. I guess there's a few things still hanging out there. This much we do know. Our conference this morning will be focused on business and education, knowing that Proposition 30 managed to gain enough support to be passed, while its rival education measure, Proposition 38, did not. My name's Dave Smith. I'm the president and CEO of United Way of Ventura County. I'm standing in this morning for Bill Barato, who is here, wasn't sure he was going to be here, because he's mentally and somewhat physically keeping track of his daughter, Sarah, who's about ready to give birth at any moment to Bill's first grandson. Asked if I would stand in for him. Now this much I do know for sure. I know Bill Barato very well, and I am not Bill Barato. You can take that however you want to take it. You know, my involvement with today's theme is really threefold. I have a business connection as a member of the Board of Directors of VECTA. I have an education connection as a member of the Executive Committee of the P16 Council that's focused on education preschool through college. And I have a United Way connection with education as part of, in support of United Way's three main focus areas, income, health, and education. So before we get started, there's always a few introductions to make. I hope we have all the elected officials on the list. If we don't, I'm sure that you'll raise your hand and be recognized. Scheduled to be with us this morning, Jim Monahan, Ventura City. Now hold your applause until we're all done, because please, I know. Jim, please sit down. Jim Monahan, Ventura City Council. Mike Morgan, Camarillo City Council. Sue Horgan, Ojai City Council. Brian Miller, representing Supervisor Peter Foy. Jess Herrera, Oxnard Harbor District Commissioner. And I haven't seen him yet, but he's supposed to be here today. Re-elected yesterday as our 44th Assembly District Assemblyman, Jeff Gorell. And the elected officials, would you stand and be recognized? I think for an event like this, it's always important to recognize the people who are dedicated and committed to the cause of VECTA, furthering the support of business efforts in our community. Members of the Board of Directors of the Ventura County Economic Development Association, would you stand and be recognized? We'd like to thank our sponsors, and again, if you please hold your applause until I get through the list. It's rather lengthy, but that's a good thing that it's lengthy. If it's short, that's not a good thing, because that means you need more sponsors. So the media sponsor, Pacific Coast Business Times. Print sponsor, Herald Printing Limited. Platinum sponsors, Agrimen, AT&T, and Volt Workforce Solutions. The gold sponsors, Aera Energy, California State University, Channel Islands, Express Employment Professionals, Global Energy and Technology. Silver sponsors, City of Thousand Oaks, Procter & Gamble, Southern California Edison, The Gas Company, and Vintage Production California. Our bronze sponsors, Alston Bird LLP, County Commerce Bank, Metropolitan Water District, Port of Wainimi, Santa Barbara Bank and Trust, Told Corporation, Venico Incorporated, and Western States Petroleum Association. Our patron sponsors, Alcoa Fastening Systems, BMW of North America, and E.J. Harrison and Sons. And very important to note is the title sponsor, California Lutheran University. And with that, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Chris Kimball to share a few thoughts with us this morning. Chris became president of CLU in April 2008 after serving as provost and vice president for academic affairs for nearly 2 years. With a distinguished career as a teacher, scholar, and academic leader, Dr. Kimball is an author and speaker on history and higher education. An undergraduate alumnus of McGill University, Chris received his master's degree and doctorate in history from the University of Chicago. He serves on numerous nonprofit and educational and economic and community boards, really a list too long to note all of them, but I will note one, the United Way of Ventura County. And with that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Chris Kimball.
morning, everybody.
Good morning.
This is teeing up the video you'll see in a little bit. It's a delight and an honor for Cal Lutheran to be the title sponsor for this important event with our partners at Visita. After yesterday's election, we know a little bit more than we did yesterday. And among those things we know is there's a lot of hard work ahead to restore economic vitality to the region and to build a durable partnership between business and education that advances this county in the years ahead. You know, Cal Lutheran kind of sits in some ways in between many of the organizations here. We are a nonprofit, but as an independent institution, we have to make our own way in the world. We have to find our own sources of revenue, and we have to keep our expenses in line, just like any private sector business does. And so we feel especially keenly the opportunities as well as the challenge in building this partnership. One of the things that the university has in its 50 plus years taken pride in is preparing Ventura County young people and not so young people to move their lives and careers forward through further education. And also bringing young and not so young people to Ventura County from other parts of the state, the country, and increasingly the world. And I have to say, many of them, when they come here, want to stay. Can't imagine why you'd want to stay in Ventura County as a transplant from Minnesota. I just don't. They want to stay, and one of the questions they have, of course, is cost of living. That's not quite as pronounced as it was a few years ago. But the question they have is, where are the jobs? Where are the career opportunities for me in Ventura County? And the opportunity to bring that kind of human capital here is a great one, but we want to keep it. We want the influx to the county not to have an outflow. This joining together of business and education also means a lot to us because our two graduate pillars of the university are in our Graduate School of Education. And I would ask our dean, George Peterson, just to stand up. We could welcome George. In his relatively short term in office as our dean, he's done a tremendous amount to bring innovation and entrepreneurship to that school, introducing new programs, new location, revising others, all in the aims of serving the needs of education in this region and beyond. Our School of Management, as we now call it, reflecting the changes that go beyond just business, but management more broadly, is an equally entrepreneurial area. And the dean, Chuck Maxey, who I'm sure many, if not all of you know, is here with us. And a great opportunity to recognize Chuck. The School of Management has, as it's been its tradition, recognized new needs, for example, around sustainability, launching programs there, around entrepreneurship, launching programs there, bringing in new faculty to enhance these areas. And I think these are examples of the sense that that school under Chuck's leadership has always had of serving the business needs of the county. I also, for the sake of preservation of my job, need to note that there are two of my bosses here from the Board of Regents. If there are three or more, and I've missed them, I'm in real trouble, but I've seen two. And I would ask Mr. Rod Gilbert and Mr. Ted Jensen just to stand up. They provide strategic leadership for Cal Lutheran. Appreciate them being here. I would just ask the other members of the CLU faculty and staff that are here with us, if you could just stand up so we could all see you and thank you for your work on behalf of the university and the county. Again, thank you all for being here. An important topic and an important day. And I look forward to hearing what the panel has to say. Dave, I'll turn it back over to you. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Chris. And it's my pleasure to introduce Stacy Roscoe, who's going to serve as the moderator for what we think is going to be an exciting discussion this morning. Stacy is a lifetime Visita board member. He's a member of the Ventura County Community Foundation Board of Directors, Casa Pacifica Board of Directors, the Ventura County Civic Alliance, and prior to his work in the nonprofit sector in the community, he was a Procter & Gamble executive in the plant in Oxnard. And Stacy will introduce our panelists. Where are you, Stacy?
Right here.
Oh, you're right here, right in front. What a novel place to be. Okay, thank you.
Good morning. Welcome everyone here. As Dave said, we're going to have an exciting panel. It's going to be challenging this morning, and I want to just let you in on a secret. We're attempting to do the impossible today. We're trying to, and we need your assistance in pulling this off. As you see, we have 8 panelists. We have opening and closing questions. We have 2 cycles of questions, each cycle with 5 questions each. So if each panel used 1 minute just to answer a question in that whole cycle, that's 40 minutes right there. So we're looking for crisp, clean questions and answers. When we have audience participation, we're asking for the same because we want to get a lot of information out. We want to involve the spectrum of the talent that we have here and the background we have here. And so the audience will have questions after each of the question cycles, and we'll end the BOC at 11:30 as scheduled. And we're queuing up a video here, which would be the first part of what we're doing. We've got a video from Seth Godin. This is a TEDx talk at Brooklyn Free School. And so the idea is to open up the box, to get outside the box in terms of some of our thinking. Now, you may agree or not agree with some of the concepts that Seth puts out here in the next few minutes, but it certainly will stretch our thinking, and that's the intent, to get warmed up before we get going. So without any further discussion on my part, let's get the video up, and then I'll call the panelists up, and we'll get the discussion started. So thank you very much.
Good morning, boys and girls. That was terrible. You've learned how to do that from a young age. You're supposed to say, good morning, Mr. Godin. So let's try again. Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning, Mr. Godin.
Have you thought about what that's for? Have you thought about how for 100 or 150 years that was ingrained into the process of public education? Have you thought at all, as people on the cutting edge, as people who are interested in making school work again, about a very simple question? What is school for? I don't think we're answering that question. I don't even think we're asking that question. Everyone seems to think they know what school is for, but we're not going to make anything happen until we can all agree about how we got here and where we're going. So my goal today is to put that question into your head and help you think about it. First, we have to understand what school used to be for. There's a woman named Mary Yvette Boole, and she came up with this notion. She was a mathematician in the late 1800s, that you could use string and nails and wood and make decorations, those things where the string goes back and forth, and there's math built into that. And that a teacher on the cutting edge of fifth graders might decide to use that idea of modulo 9 and remainders and string going back and forth to teach an important lesson about math. So the memo went home to all the parents at my kids' public school, and it said, we need help with this. We need hammers. So I'm sort of unemployed. I showed up at school that day with a bag of hammers, a big bag of 18 hammers. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard 18 kids hitting nails with 18 hammers in a little room for 20 minutes, but I have. And I'm not going to do it for you because it's really hard to listen to. And what the teacher explained to the kids is they must arrange the brads in this certain pattern, hammering, 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 and make sure they're in there nice and firm. And so these kids are hammering, 20 minutes of zero education, just 20 minutes of hammering. And then the teacher walks over and she says to her boy, I told you to make sure the brads were all the way in. And one by one, she pulled them out and threw them on the floor, every single one, and put the board down. And that is what she believed school was for. School was about teaching obedience. Good morning, boys and girls, starts the day with respect and obedience. Now I have to move on to Frederick J. Kelly. Some of you have brought your own number two pencil for the quiz that's going to be part of today. The number two pencil is famous because Frederick J. Kelly made it famous. Back around World War I, we had a problem, which was this huge influx of students, because we had expanded the school day to include high school. And there was this huge need to sort them all out. So he invented the standardized test, an abomination. And he gave it up 10 years later when the emergency was over. But because he gave it up, because he called it up, because he said the standardized test is too crude to be used, he was ostracized and lost his job as the president of a university. Because he dared to speak up against a system that was working. So let's try a little experiment here. I'd like everyone to go ahead and raise your right hand just as high as you possibly can. Now please raise it a little higher. What's that about? My instructions were pretty clear, yet you all held back. How come? You held back because you've been taught since you were 3 years old to hold a little bit back. Because if you do everything, if you put all out, then your parent or your teacher or your coach or your boss is going to ask for a little bit more, aren't they? And the reason they will is because we are products of the industrial age. The industrial age made us all rich. The industrial age brought productivity to the table. Productivity allows human beings working together with a boss and a manager to make more than they could ever make alone. Productivity makes us a car for $700 instead of $700,000 in 1920. But the thing about productivity and industrialism is this. The people who ran factories had two huge problems. Problem number one, they looked around and they said, we don't have enough workers. We don't have enough people who are willing to move off the farm and come to this dark building for 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, and do what they are told. If we could get more workers, we could pay them less. And if we could pay them less, we'd make more money. We need more workers. And so the KKK went to industrialists and said, you need to get those kids out of the factories, those people you're paying $3 a day, because they're taking our jobs. And so a deal was made. And the deal was universal public education, whose sole intent was not to train the scholars of tomorrow. We had plenty of scholars. It was to train people to be willing to work in the factory. It was to train people to behave, to comply, to fit in. We process you for a whole year. If you are defective, we hold you back and process you again. We sit you in straight rows, just like they organize things in the factory. We build a system all about interchangeable people. Because factories are based on interchangeable parts. If this piece is no good, put another piece in there. And org charts, those little boxes, are all designed to say, oh, we can fit Bob in there because Rachel didn't go to work today. And so we built school. That's what school was for. And the second thing industrialists were really worried about was that we weren't going to buy all the stuff they could make. That in 1880, 1890, people owned two pairs of shoes, one pair of jeans. That was it. Right? You don't know anyone who owns one pair of jeans anymore, ever. What they needed to train us to do was buy stuff. They needed to train us to fit in. They needed to train us to become consumers. And so Horace Mann, who meant well, built the public school as we know it. And then he needed more teachers, right? Because you have more schools. So he built a school for teachers. You know what it's called? The normal school. He called it the normal school, where they trained people to teach in the common school, because he wanted you to be normal. And he wanted the class to be normal. And he wanted people to fit in. And then we came up with this, the textbook. Now, if you want to teach somebody how to become passionate about, I don't know, American history, why would you give them this? Do people walk into Barnes & Noble and say, I'm really interested in that latest gripping thing that's going to get me all engaged about the Civil War? Do you have one of those textbooks in stock? If you wanted to teach someone how to be a baseball fan, would you start by having them understand the history of baseball and who Abner Doubleday was and what barnstorming was and the influences of cricket and capitalism and the Negro Leagues? Would you do that? Would you say, okay, there's a test tomorrow. I want you to memorize the top 50 batters in order by batting average, and then rank the people based on how they do on the test. So the ones who do well get to memorize more baseball players? Is that how we would create baseball fans? Here's the key distinction. What people do, quite naturally, is if it's work, they try to figure out how to do less. And if it's art, we try to figure out how to do more. And when we put kids in the factory we call school, the thing we built to indoctrinate them into compliance, why are we surprised that the question is, will this be on the test? Right? Someone who's making art doesn't say, can I do one less canvas this month? They don't say, can I write one less song this month? They don't say, can I touch one fewer person this month? It's art. They want to do more of it. But when it's work, when it's your job, when you're 7, of course you want to do less of it. So one of the things that I've done as an avocation is when I meet people, I take this out. This is a great bargain online. And it's filled with these blocks, right? You've probably seen blocks before. I'm going to dump it out over there. And I say, take 4 blocks and make them into something interesting. Now, it's an interesting question, because you can use the letters, or you can use the shapes. You can spell a word. You can put a profanity there. You can spell a word that means nothing. You can make the shape into a bridge. And people hate this, because there's no right answer, and there's a million wrong answers. They hate this because there's no dummy's guide to how to make something interesting out of blocks when you're 30 years old. And now we're at a crossroads. We're at a crossroads because as a culture, we say, the only thing we care about, the only place we're willing to cross the street to go, the only thing we're willing to buy, the only person we're willing to vote for, the only stuff we're willing to talk about is interesting, is art, is new, will touch us, is valuable. And then we spend all of our money and all of our time teaching people not to do that. And so we're now at this crossroads because technology is here too. And the technology says, you know what? For the first time in history, we do not need a human being to stand next to us to teach us to do square roots. For the first time in history, we do not need a human being to teach us how to sharpen an axe, because the internet connects us all. And so I want to share with you 8 things that I think are going to change completely if we decide how we want to answer this question, or maybe even if we don't. 1, as Sal Khan has pointed out, homework during the day, lectures at night. World-class lecturers lecturing on anything you want to learn to every single person in the world who's got an internet connection for free. And then all day, go and sit with a human being, a teacher, and ask your questions and do your work and explore face to face. It's stupid to have the same lecture being given handmade 10,000 times a day across the country when we can get one person to do it great for the people who want to hear it. 2, open book, open note all the time. There is zero value in memorizing anything ever again. Anything that is worth memorizing is worth looking up. So we shouldn't spend any time teaching people to memorize stuff. 3, access to any course anywhere in the world anytime you want to take it. So this notion that we have to do things in a certain order, which is based on physical location and chronology, makes no sense. 4, precise, focused education instead of mass batch stuff. That's the way we make almost everything we buy now. Right? It used to be you could have any color car you want as long as it was black, so we could keep the assembly line going. But now, they make 10,000 kinds of cars, because they can. So we should make 10,000 kinds of education. No more multiple choice exams. Those were invented to make them easy to score, but computers are smarter than that. Measuring experience instead of test scores, because experience is what we really care about. The end of compliance as an outcome. The resume is proof that you have complied for years and years and years with famous brand names, and it gets you your next job. It's worthless now. And cooperation instead of isolation. Why do we do anything where we ask people to do it all by themselves when then we put them in the real world and say, cooperate. Four more. Teacher's role transforms into coach. Lifelong learning with work happening earlier in your life. And really important, the death of the famous college. Not good college. We don't know what a good college is, but we know what a famous college is because someone ranked them as famous or because they have a football team that's famous. Why on earth are we paying extra? Why on earth are we working harder to comply and be obedient just so we can get a famous brand name that has no relevance to success or happiness put after our name? I want to show you one more device I have over here as I start to do this. This is called an Arduino, and it's a little bit like a Raspberry Pi. They're both electronic devices that cost $20 to $30 each. Raspberry Pi, which you can buy for $25, has on it the complete Linux operating system, a USB port, audio out, and a monitor. So if we take that cable and that keyboard and that monitor we already have in front of almost every kid in this country and hand them one of these, we can then say to them, go build something interesting and ask if you need help. Why wouldn't we want to teach our kids to go do something interesting? Why wouldn't we want to teach our kids to figure it out? And yet, every day we send kids to school and say, do not figure it out. Do not ask questions I do not know the answer to. Do not look it up. Do not vary from the curriculum. And better, 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 comply. Fit in. Be like your peers. Do what you're told, because I must process you, because everything in my evaluation is based on whether or not I processed you properly. So there are two myths I want to close with. The first one, and we got to be really honest with ourselves about this. Myth one, great performance in school leads to happiness and success. If that's not true, we should stop telling ourselves it is. And two, great parents have kids who produce great performance in school. If that's not true, we should stop telling ourselves it is. Are we asking our kids to collect dots or connect dots? Because we're really good at measuring how many dots they collect, how many facts they have memorized, how many boxes they have filled in. But we teach nothing about how to connect those dots. You cannot teach connecting dots in a dummy's manual. You cannot teach connecting dots in a textbook. You can only do it by putting kids into a situation where they can fail. Grades are an illusion. Passion and insight are reality. Your work is more important than your congruence to an answer key. Persistence in the face of a skeptical authority figure is priceless, and yet we undermine it. Fitting in is a short-term strategy that gets you nowhere. Standing out is a long-term strategy that takes guts and produces results. If you care enough about your work to be willing to be criticized for it, then you have done a good day's work. So what now? What now? What should we do? Because we've been talking about it a whole lot. Only one thing. Ask the question. What is school for? When they say, this is our new textbook, the question is that going to help us with getting what school is for? When they say, this is the new superintendent, we need to say, yes. But is this superintendent going to help us do what we think school is for? And if you don't know what school is for, then have a conversation about it. Because until we can agree what school is for, we're not going to get what we need. Thank you for the work you do. I appreciate it.
How's that for getting the morning started? With that, I'd like to call our panel members up here, and we'll get everyone introduced briefly. I'll refer you to the program here, which is a little different than we have in the past because people pretty well know who's on the panel because we've been working with these folks for, by and large, a long time. We've asked each of them to, instead of a biography, put a statement or a thought relative to education. So with each picture and name, you'll find a little bit of a statement. Take a minute to take a look at that, and I think it'll be helpful in terms of understanding some of the perspectives that our panel members are coming from. So if all the panel could assemble, we have it set up so that there's a mix and a match between the business community and the education community. Particular order.
Everyone find their name.
Okay. My brief introduction, what I'd like to do is recognize each of the people on the panel. We have Stan Mantooth, Ventura County Superintendent of Schools. We have Richard Rush, President, California State University, Channel Islands.
We have Jamila
Moore, Chancellor, Ventura County Community College District. You heard from Chris Kimball, President, California Lutheran University. Bill Pratt, Vice President of Operations, KineMed.
Henry Dubroff,
a publisher, Pacific Coast Business Times. Bill Camarillo, Chief Executive Officer of Agrimen.
Gary Wild,
President and CEO of Community Memorial Health System. Right ingredients up here in terms of having a great discussion. I'd like to start off in terms of an icebreaker here in terms of the discussion. It's a two-part question, and you can pick what parts you want to do or not to deal with. The first is dealing with the election last night and any thoughts that you may have relative to how it affects what we're here to talk about today. And the second one is, are there any thoughts, again, brief thoughts relative to the video that we just saw in terms of getting on the table for our discussion? Would anybody care to kick off those two? Henry, you had your hand halfway up, I saw it.
Great to be able to start out a morning where there's been both significant change and very little change, depending on which election you're looking at and what's going on. There are two thoughts on my part. One, on Proposition 30, one of the interesting things about this is that Jerry Brown, who wasn't on the ballot, was a big winner. And his thought was to go big. And I think one of the lessons is that we are going to need to go big federally if we're going to resolve the fiscal cliff. And whether there's courage out there to go big on both parties, that's a real question. The second thing, when it comes to education, Prop 30 was the winner. Again, that puts a lot of money, at least we hope it puts a lot of money into the schools. There's going to be a lot of pressure on the schools to deliver. So just as the video said, there's going to be a lot of pressure on the schools to go big and be innovative, because if schools don't deliver, there's going to be a backlash. And the third thing I would say is that I really believe for the economy, and Bill Watkins is in the audience from SURF at Cal Lutheran, immigration reform and economic opportunity are getting much, much, much more linked in the congressional race. You saw that with Julia Brownlee beating Tony Strickland by a really thin margin, mainly Latino votes. There's a lot of push for immigration reform, and that should produce more small businesses. It should really provide an opportunity for educators to educate. Entrepreneurship education is going to be extremely important, and I'll just stop there.
Great. Thank you very much. Stan.
Well, you know, one of the ways the question could be asked is, what will we do? What would education do if 30 didn't pass? And I think the greater question is, what would everyone do if 30 didn't pass? What are they going to do about the future, both immediate in terms of a school year that might be 3 weeks shorter, and in the longer term, training the raw material that you all need as business people for the next generation? We dodged that bullet. Let us also be mindful that we are still dealing with a 20% reduction in our funding. And yet, to a certain degree, that's irrelevant. We keep doing what we do, and we keep persevering regardless of those things. And in many ways, we've actually learned to work smarter, and we certainly are working harder. As to the video, you know, a lot of people say change is one of our most important constants. Well, some things don't change because nobody's sitting in the front row, so whether you're an educator or a business person. And you also didn't get the message that there were free $100 Starbucks cards for anybody who sat down there, you know, which we're now rescinding. But a lot is changing. It's kind of like not seeing the forest for the trees, or as the French would say, fish are the last to discover water. In this building and the breakout rooms, we conduct about 90% of all the professional development for teachers in the K-12 system. And if they watch that video, some would chuckle and most would say, so, that's what we're doing. That's 21st century and that's 21st century learning. And those are the activities we are engaged in, and we are engaged in that transition as we speak. And it does bear fruit, and it is congruent with where we need to go in the future.
Thanks, Dan. Bill?
I think the we backed away from the precipice with the passage of Prop 30. My involvement with the Workforce Investment Board focused on career technical education is that we were looking at the termination of career technical education. As somebody from industry where we have no next generation to run our factories, we're about 20 years out now in my own factory. Most of my employees will age out in 5 to 10 years. As I work with the, I work in the life sciences, and as I compare notes in a couple of trade associations that I'm associated with, we all have the same problem. Our skilled workers are getting old, and there are no 20-year-olds. There are no 30-year-olds there. The primary generator of wealth in this society is manufacturing. We are involved with the transformation of materials. We take dirt and we turn it into extremely valuable stuff that all people buy. Without that wealth generator, there won't be the wealth to fund public pensions. There won't be the wealth to fund public education and so on. So we're very, very close. We're in a crisis which is finally being recognized at the federal level. The president started talking about it about 2 years ago. We did reauthorize the Workforce Investment Act last year. And with a little bit of luck, we'll get things straightened out before January 1st, and that funding will continue. So we're at a critical crossroads. In terms of the video, I'm married to a New York painter. So you can imagine that the climate in my household was very supportive of the sentiments that were expressed there. I have a son who's at the Rochester Institute of Technology in his second year. It's a fantastic hands-on private polytechnic school. And all of his classmates would be very comfortable with that video. All they do is think about stuff they want to make and then go out and make it. That's an exciting environment, which flies in contrast to the speaker's assessment of where public education is at. One of the things that I talk about at the Workforce Investment Board is that the educational standards, No Child Left Behind, I think is strangling the educational experience. And I think the first thing that we need to do in this country is jettison that, that we need to go back to that spirit of creative teaching. And the primary reason for that is that the school districts and the teachers, because they're scored by standardized testing, they game the system. And the kids know the teachers are gaming the system, and the kids game the teachers. So you've got basically a disintegration of ethics in education, if you will. And this has gone, been going on now for about, was it about 10 years, I guess, that No Child Left Behind's been in force? And there was a, Since 2000, and that's affected my kids. I've got a senior at Thousand Oaks High School, has a completely cynical viewpoint of education. Thankfully, they have an entrepreneurship academy there, which has really sparked his interest. But I think No Child Left Behind is all children left behind, especially the brighter kids. So that's kind of my viewpoint. And lastly, and I may come back to this, is that as I meet with people from the Cal State system and UC, to reinvigorate the support for career technical education, I would love, and this is a personal thing of my own, is that all applicants to engineering schools in California be required to have a high school shop class as part of their high school experience, so that shop classes now, there'll be a huge interest in them. Because if we don't introduce kids to working with their hands and their heads, they're not going to think about it maybe until they get into their 30s and they don't have work, which is the case we have now. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bill. Dick, and then we'll get back to Jamila.
A couple of things about Proposition 30 from the point of view of the California State University. The first is that we will get no new money as a result of the passage of Proposition 30. That's the good news. The bad news, of course, if it had failed, would be that we'd lose another $250 million, which would total $1.5 billion reduction in the last 4 years. Now, the other part of the good news of the passage of Proposition 30 is that the governor is requiring the Board of Trustees to roll back tuition 9% to last fall's totals. We must refund that 9% before the end of this year. So that's going to be an interesting proposition to find the students, to give them back their 9%, and then we have to repackage all of the financial aid and return that to the students and to the government as well before the end of the year. As a reward for doing this, the governor is going to give us $125 million in February. That means the net win for us is a loss of $7 million. That's what we get out of the passage of Proposition 30. But if it had not passed, this community would be in dire straits insofar as it relies upon us as one of the providers of the workforce. We've been capped in our enrollment for the past 4 years. We're now at 5,000 headcount. We would be over 7,000 right now, because we're accepting 1 in 15 applicants because of lack of resources. So that 4-year moratorium means that you as employers are now beginning to find that 2,000 plus potential employees are not there for you right now. And this will roll out over the next 3 years as well. Regarding the video that we saw, I give him credit for passion. He may have had a bad school experience himself, but one of the things that he didn't pick up was that assumptions do not prove conclusions. And when you look at the number of assumptions that he has about schools and they and the people and on, it becomes a matter of loss of credibility. The one thing I would emphasize, though, is that learning and teaching is changing rapidly, not only because of electronics and the way that kids learn walking around with handheld devices. That's their world. They communicate in ways that I certainly, and possibly you, can only come to as visitors from another planet. For them, it is their lives. And so in the university, we are finding that we have to change the way that we help students learn. One of the ways is something that he did suggest, and that's what's called flipping. Flipping involves turning it over so that at night you have the lecture, and in the daytime, the faculty member is your coach and mentor and helps you understand the material instead of the way that I and possibly you went through school and learned it. The other he also adverts to is MOOCs, multiple open online courses where you can find possibly someone from Ethiopia or London or somewhere who is a world expert at a point in time giving a lecture on a particular subject where students can learn that and then come with a mentor or coach in the classroom and either do a hands-on experiment or discuss the concepts that are contained therein. So I want to emphasize that in the university, and I'm sure Chris will say the same thing, Jamila as well, it's not the same way that we all learned. It's changing rapidly because the faculty are changing rapidly to become leaders of the next generation of your workforce.
Thanks, Dick. Jamila.
Thank you. I woke up this morning pleasantly surprised by the outcome because I really anticipated it would be different. But as some of my other colleagues have indicated, Proposition 30 is not a windfall of money. I am really fortunate to work in the largest higher education institution in the world, the community college system, 112 colleges, 72 districts, 2.6 million students. What we do every day is we are building the bridge between the K through 12 system and higher education. If community colleges are not allowed to do their job, you will see the population dwindle at the four-year institutions, both the CSU, the UC, and the private independents. I had yesterday written two statements before leaving the office. One, if Proposition 30 was not successful, and one, if Proposition 30 was. So instead of having a $9 million hole in which we would have to try and build or fill by January 1, I now break even. And so I think the real conversation we're beginning to have is, how do you sustain the goal and the mission of the Master Plan for Higher Education, which is a fantastic document, but at the time that it was put together, you know, they weren't even charging tuition at UC or CSU. And so we are trying to sustain quality education within a state where we have not only limited resources, but in some cases, no resources at all, and tremendous need. So I have to say that we have to work in partnership. That's the only way we can continue. And we will be forced to think outside the box because we don't have a box in certain cases anymore. And so we are moving towards the direction of being much more streamlined. As for the video, I think it offers some nice alternatives, but in the environment of where I work in community colleges, we deal with individuals who are either coming right out of high school or adult learners or veterans. The need is extremely diverse, and so we have to be diverse in our learning, which means we have to be extremely flexible. So I look forward to hearing other comments from the rest of the panels. Thank you.
Chris.
In watching that video, I said, okay, thought-provoking, kind of fun, wish he'd paid more attention to history class.
Yeah.
He got some things right, but mangled some very key ones. Yes, there was a notion that schools should prepare workers in an industrial society. That's an element of truth. But for Horace Mann and others that he didn't mention, there was also an important civic responsibility that education was to prepare citizens who could conduct themselves and their affairs, govern themselves in a republic. And I would think that part of education is still very important. Whether or not you're happy with the election results yesterday, I think most people would agree that civic responsibility in our society is not at a high point. And that needs to remain in education. It wasn't just about preparing people for industrial jobs, in part because Horace Mann and those others knew that those jobs were not permanent. And one of the things we have to be careful of is not thinking 2 and 3 years out, but much further than that, because most of the jobs people are going to be going into, we haven't even thought of yet. We don't know their existence. If we're preparing people to be milkmen doing deliveries like when I was a kid, that's probably not a great strategic choice. So I think we have to introduce some other elements besides simply seeing this as a response to one particular form of economic production. And as others have alluded to, Godin should get out and go into some classrooms occasionally. Yes, if you're doing warehouse-style education, where everybody's sitting, listening to a lecturer or eight lecturers, none of them would be as good as we are, taking notes, not sitting in the front row, et cetera. If you have these kind of numbers, that's the way you teach. But the advantage of having smaller class sizes, which those in public education would love to get back to, is you can do just the kind of creative things that he talks about. I'll just lift up a project that's come out of our Graduate School of Education, where some of our faculty are in schools, in elementary schools, where they are using techniques of drama, of theater, of acting, to teach the entire curriculum, to generate that kind of creativity among kids that Godin was talking about. And as Dick alluded to, classrooms are being flipped. There are all kinds of wonderful things that are going on. The question is, do we want to continue or to support them in greater ways that we're doing now? Stan alluded to, or actually maybe it was Bill, on the No Child Left Behind. There was a speaker here in the county a month or two ago, writes for Corwin Press, the SAGE imprint that does education publications. He's a Chinese national who's come and made a career in this country. And he said, you know, in China, they are trying to get away from standardized testing as a measure of education because they realize they need innovation and entrepreneurship the way Americans have always done it. And they can't quite figure out why we seem to be going in their direction, to become more rigid, less innovative, less entrepreneurial. So I'd have loved Godin to have tackled those issues rather than haranguing us about the failures of lecture as a teaching technique, which I think anybody in education recognizes. Like any other technique, it has strengths and weaknesses.
Thanks, Chris. Gary.
It's unusual for the California Hospital Association to endorse a ballot initiative, but we put precious dollars and a lot of dollars in support of Proposition 30. The reason was twofold. Firstly, the healthcare industry is completely dependent on education. We will not have adequately trained nurses or physicians or physical therapists without strong education. And so we saw this as a real need. In a way, it's research and development in our mind. And so we went all out. Some of the ads you heard, and we were inundated with ads, but some of you may have heard at the end of support Proposition 30, supported by the California Hospital Association. And again, that's a rare thing for us. None of us wants to pay more taxes. Nobody in the room does. But in terms of the critical need to support education, we felt this was a time where we had to make a very decisive policy statement, and that's why we supported it. We were delighted that it got passed. We had a meeting last week, and we saw the numbers, polling numbers declining, and so we're delighted that it was, in fact, passed. So we're happy about that. Again, nobody wants to pay more taxes, but this was an absolute critical need. The other reason that we supported it, we recognized that if funding for schools was to become even more draconian, it wouldn't stop with just education. It would have to hit healthcare. It would have to hit other public services. The state of California budget would have to reach in other areas now leanly budgeted and funded, and so we took a stand on that. With regard to the video, this is the third time I saw it, and I loved, it was thought-provoking, and I love the idea of being creative and introduce new ideas. In a temporary lapse of judgment, after 25 years of being out of school, I decided to go back to school to get a doctorate degree, and I was amazed at how different education had become. I was amazed at how instant research was. And the comparison in that 25 years from the time I completed my master's degree until I completed my doctorate degree, education has changed tremendously. And the creativity and the methods were so much improved, and I would credit our educators here in the stand for being part of that. Education has improved. In healthcare, we don't encourage a lot of creativity in how you take care of a patient. We don't encourage our phlebotomists to be creative in how to take blood, or our pharmacists of what drugs to dispense despite the way the physicians had ordered. So for us, conformity is a good thing. We strongly support evidence-based medicine. We learn from each other, and we share that knowledge and conformity and doing the things right way. And so we would disagree respectfully to the presenter that just be creative, do things you, we have to be, you have to conform in certain ways. Curricula are important, and so, but I do like the idea of thinking outside the box. Are there better ways, are there less expensive ways to educate? I'd be in favor of that, but we have to have conformity in our industry.
Thanks, Gary. And the last one in this cycle is Bill.
Last but not least, right?
Last but not least. You'll have a chance to be best other than last, believe me.
Best for last. Well, thanks for having me here today, and I hope I represent the voice of business. And with a raise of hands, how many businessmen do we have in the audience? Great. We live in a battlefield, and I'm a product of the education system. I'm 49 years old. I spent 10 years in the Marine Corps. It took me 16 years to get my MBA. Over the last 20 years, I've built a very successful business in the green industry. Didn't know it back then. And today, my focus is on sustainability. And my concerns are that, as a country, we're not sustainable. If we continue to borrow money to survive, that is not sustainable. Businesses, if they had to focus and live that way, would not be sustainable. The only reason you would borrow money is to grow a business, not to survive. So with the election yesterday, nothing got fixed. All it did was let me understand what the rules are going to be going forward, because I have to navigate every day with rules. And Dr. Watkins, I believe, is here, taught me something about a year ago called DIRT: delay, uncertainty, regulation, and taxes. I deal with it every day. So all the election did for me was help me clear up some uncertainty, so that I know how to navigate. With the video, you're going to hear me harp on probably four things today: inspiration, passion, failure, and art. We have a successful model. They used art and technology to create one of the largest companies in the world today, called Apple. Agerman has tried to follow that pattern and use art and technology to take wasted resources, convert them back into a usable resource so we could grow food cheaper than the rest of the world, because we do feed the country. So with that, I'm looking forward to the other questions and hope that I can bring some light to what we receive as the product of the education system today. And is all the change we're talking about really good?
Thanks, Bill.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and now let's just get on to the first cycle here, and I'm going to take the moderator's prerogative here of combining two of the questions in each category. There are two that are designed for the educators, two designed for the business people, and I'm going to put them together in one question, and you can address each aspect of it. And on this one, I'm expecting the educators to deal primarily with the education questions. We don't necessarily need or have time for everybody to chime in terms of a full answer. If you have a question or concern from the other side of the perspective, certainly offer that up. But we'll start with the educators, and then we'll go to the business questions and flip-flop that way. The composite education question: how are our local educational institutions preparing Ventura County students to make a meaningful connection with the world of work before they finish school? Many students are not interested in pursuing academics. It seems that there's an opportunity for business educational partnership. What is being done in grades 7 through 12 to plant seeds of interest for those students? So you can see these are very closely allied questions. And so I'd like to start with the education community with that. Anyone want to jump in to start that one off? Stan?
Well, you did mention 712, yeah. So I think that might fall within my purview.
You know something about 712, huh?
Well, we like to think so, anyway. You know, first of all, I would like to ask you to think of education itself as a business. If it were a business, it would be the third largest in the state. So our aims, you know, our objectives are really not different. And in many ways, we put ourselves on a business basis. And what we're doing is, as I mentioned before, preparing raw material for your world. And the way that we do that, most importantly, not knowing what all the jobs are going to be 5 years from now, let alone 20, is to work on basic skills. Like, believe it or not, having kids do writing in every single subject, expository narrative writing in every single subject, to use deliberative skills and creativity and entrepreneurship in everything they do, whether it's physical education or physics or social science. Those kinds of foundations, the ability of people to work with one another and communicate are the things which you tell us you need. Beyond that, we use the term college and career ready. And there's a lot going on, actually more than I believed was going on until we conducted a survey recently in conjunction with the Workforce Investment Board. And I don't really want to differentiate college from career because it almost sounds like, okay, you go to college and then you don't get a job. Well, that may be true in some cases in the current economy. But you go to college because of what you want to pursue. You want to pursue as a private good, as well, you know, for your own edification, as well as putting you on a path to being a lifelong learner, but also to work at a meaningful job after you've left that system. Not everybody goes there, not everybody has a chance. And in the current economy, one of the ironies is that we're working hard to develop the talent to move to community colleges and our four-year universities and not having enough slots for them. And so there's a rich, rich territory in careers. And in terms of what our schools are doing in that area, I don't know whether, how many of you have heard the term academy? Okay. Academies still embrace all of what we consider to be the A to G core subjects, but also concentrated fields of learning. Law enforcement, engineering, health careers. Those are three academies, and those three are in the Oxnard Union High School District at three of their high schools. Throughout the county, we've got 15 of them, and we've got three of them in our middle schools. And what those students do is they pursue an area of interest, and sometimes they don't get in because they're a waiting list. They pursue an area of interest which allows them to sequentially take courses leading to what we call a capstone course and a senior project as well as an internship. So they're preparing themselves early on. Our biggest challenge is to get that, to push that down into the middle schools. And I believe it was Senate Bill 70, Dr. Moore, which provides the community colleges with grant money to be able to go into our middle schools and help kids make choices at the right time. Because sometimes by the time you get to high school, it might be too late. Career assessments and pathways courses are going on in virtually every one of our school districts that has a middle or a high school in this county. So I think we're well on our way to doing that. And another comment about testing. The State Board of Education is meeting today, and they're going to be considering what the next type of assessment is going to be because our STAR test, the standardized test, is going to sunset in 2014. We think that's a damn good thing. Okay? And that assessment is going to be technologically based, and it's not going to be a bubble test or a multiple choice. Because, yes, we continue to do remarkably well, you know, on tests like that for the when in the past 30 years our student population has increased by 50%. But our minority and English language learner population has increased by 382%. But where we're falling down, and you're going to see this in an upcoming publication done by the Civic Alliance, is in what we call our early assessment program. And that is a determinant of how well kids are prepared to actually succeed in college. And it doesn't look good, folks. It really doesn't look good. Kids need to learn to write better. They need to do math better. And one of the reasons is that we have not been in as good of alignment with our institutions of higher education as we need to be. The new, what we call Common Core, and you're going to hear that word a lot, you're going to hear the expression California Common Core State Standards, actually finally bring us into greater alignment with our colleges, and that is going to be our next big work for our kids, whether they decide to go on to college or college and a certificate program or another type of program. And I don't want to fail to mention our regional occupational program. Our core is at Camarillo Airport, and we do everything from auto body to welding to paramedic training. But we have those courses in 36 of our schools in the county as well. And they're just great incubators for those that want to make different kinds of choices and also need a very robust education and basic grounding. Because if any of you have tried to work on the engine in your car in the last 10 years, you open the hood and you're looking at a black box. It's not like the old days where you had a timing light and a dwell meter. And so the world is a very different place, and the students have to understand very complex academic drop-down computerized menus and technology as a completely transparent tool.
Thanks, Dan. Dick.
To give you some insight on how we at California State University Channel Islands see the relationship with the business community, I would offer, first of all, that we see it as a continuum. We exist for you in part. We are part of the development of your workforce. To that end, then, we see what we do as a partnership with you. And so we have advisory boards for virtually everything that we do. We try to listen. What have we done in listening? Well, we started a nursing program because there was a nursing crisis. And I went around to Gary and to the other hospitals and I said, do you want a Bachelor of Science in Nursing? They all said yes. And I said, thank you. Will you pay for it? Because the state will not pay for high cost programs. Gary and his colleagues said yes, and that began it. We received money from the county, from the tobacco settlement, from donors, from Elton Gallagher's work to give us a simulation lab. The only participant in this partnership that was absent was the state of California. And the nursing program exists to this day on that basis. We extended it to Santa Barbara County because Cottage Health System said, we need you to bring the nursing program up here. And as usual, I had my hand out and I said, will you pay for it? And they said yes. And so they gave us $6 million to put the nursing program in Santa Barbara County. We are now listening to the community in an effort to assist in creating jobs. Jeff Gorell talked with me and said, I'm developing the gold team. I said, you can count me in. I said, what do you need? And he said, well, we want to keep an industry here that may leave the state. I said, fine, we'll create an engineering program to support that effort. Continuing on, I would also offer that everything we do is interdisciplinary from day one. And so what? Everything you do in your businesses every single day is interdisciplinary. You don't just look at something from the cost, you look at it from benefits, you look at it from marketing, you look at it from sales, and on and on. We try to teach our students to look at issues or problems from multiple perspectives so that when they come to you, they will be ready. But there's something else that I would like to add, and Chris alluded to it and so did Stan. Education isn't just a private good for the individuals. Please take this to heart. It is also a public good for our republic, for our democracy. If we don't have people who are prepared to sustain our way of living, our democracy will be in real trouble. So we try, as educators, to assist individuals to develop their talents to their capacity for their benefit, yes, for all of business and industry's benefit, yes. And we try to help them create an ethical and moral basis so that they will be leaders in our democratic society. Please don't underestimate that. I think all eight of us would agree on that basis that unless both of those components emerge from the educational process, we have not served the individuals well, we have not served business and industry well, and we have certainly not served our democracy well.
Thanks, Dick. Jamila.
Thank you. I would add that I agree 100% with almost everything that everyone before me has said. What we are doing in this area is, you know, community colleges, the perception has been, because we have an open admission process, that everybody come. Well, our mission has changed because, as individuals have indicated, it's about getting people to work, but you have to have a skilled workforce to put to work. And what we are doing, unfortunately, is picking up where K through 12 has left off, and that is, unfortunately, that 85% to 90% of the students that come into a community college are testing below college level in math and English. So where we used to have an open system of trying to just serve the community, because of reduced resources, our mission has changed. The statewide chancellor 2 years ago redefined the mission for community colleges into three areas, that of transfer, basic skills, career technical education. And so what we are doing is twofold. First of all, in the basic skills area, we are working to ensure that individuals can pass entry-level exams for the state or for the federal level to get jobs. We're ensuring that individuals can pass English 101 or Math 195 so that they can get into college preparatory courses and then transfer. In the area of career technical education, as Stan has alluded to, under SB 70, we are working with our partners in business to help train individuals to go into workforce. I believe Ventura County has over 900 manufacturers in this area. Our economic workforce development section in the district is working to build those partnerships to find those skilled workers for individuals who have industries that they want to fill. How many of you have, in the last year or so, had a job opening where you've had to interview folks? I ask that question because I'm sure some of you probably had difficulty finding two things, a strong work ethic and someone who could come in and deal with some of the basic fundamentals of what you were looking for and to place that person in a job. And your circumstance is not unique. So we are realizing and living every day that we have got to work hand in hand in partnership. So we are doing what we need to do on the level of career technical education, but we understand it's about training folks. 70% of individuals who are getting nursing degrees are coming out of community college. We're also training individuals up to 75% to 80% in law enforcement and in emergency preparedness are coming through the community college. We met yesterday with the police chief of Port Hueneme because she had indicated that while we have difficult budgetary times, our reserve academy at Ventura College is where she gets 80% to 85% of her police force. So we're now sitting at the table to say, okay, if we can sustain that, we have to work together to kind of move that forward. So community colleges are in three areas, but those are just some examples of how we're trying to work in partnership with business so that we can make sure that the future will hopefully look a little bit brighter, but that so that people do have jobs to go to, but that they're trained in order to be successful.
Thanks, Jamal. Chris.
There are a couple of things in the culture right now that are miss in the sense that they're wrong. One of them is that a four-year college degree really isn't worth it anymore. I've heard that said more in the last year or two in this recession than ever before. The fact is, a four-year degree is worth more now than it ever has been. The difference in someone's life trajectory with a four-year degree is greater than it's ever been before. Obviously, I'm a partisan of the four-year degree. That's what my institution does. But this nation, more perhaps than this county, is looking at a dramatic shortfall in four-year degree prepared citizens and workers going forward. And if we lose track of that, our global competitiveness is going to erode. The second myth is one Dick addressed very well, and that is that somehow college education is divorced from work, or as the question was phrased, there's academics and then there's work. That distinction is not terribly meaningful anymore. I can't think of an example on our campus where there's an academic program that doesn't have hands-on components in it, because we want two things out of our graduates. One is that they be good at whatever they go on to do, that they get the best training, the best education, they learn from practitioners as well as theorists, that they get out and do the work as interns and in other ways, but also that they understand what it means to be an ethical citizen and employee, so they're a worker that you can hire and trust. And obviously, as an independent institution, we can do a lot around ethics. We want the employees that you hire from us also to be capable of innovative, creative thought. I now maybe will dissuade them from going to work for Gary.
It's fun.
I'm sort of kidding on
that.
That's
fun.
They need experience and get experience working on teams, because that's what they're going to have to do for you. So this sort of cultural disassociation of college and work, it seems to me, is largely meaningless now and gets in the way of what we need to do. I think one of the great challenges for California, Dick mentioned the absence of the state on some of these, is also evident in thinking strategically about educational needs at the 2- and 4-year degree level. The folks here from education at this table are very collaborative. We're lucky here in this county. And I have to say, at Cal Lutheran, we get more students from Moore Park College than from any other secondary or post-secondary institution in the country. We have a wonderful relationship there. So we have a very collaborative higher ed world here. But statewide, I can tell you in Sacramento, when the legislators sit down to think about higher ed needs, including capacity, they sit down with the UCs, they sit down with the Cal State system and the community college system, the independent colleges and universities are not at the table. And I get turf and all that sort of thing. But the facts are this: 20% of the undergraduates in California get degrees come from independent colleges and universities. 50% of the master's degrees in California come from independent colleges and universities, and 60% of the doctoral degrees. If we're to deal with these capacity questions, the independent sector needs to be at the table too, because I'll also say we get students through faster and at far less burden on the taxpayers. Until the state steps in and says, throughout the state, how about instead of a private institution and a public one both starting the same program in the same field down the road from each other, why not do it collaboratively? Let's get beyond the wall of public, private, church versus state stuff. Let's find a way to collaborate there, because I'm not sure that the resources are there for the kind of duplication that we see. I think that's an enormous challenge. The influence that any of you have with your state legislators, say, start asking that question. How can we tap both the independent sector and the public sector to work together to provide this education that we are all doing now that meaningfully prepares people to go into your workplace?
Thanks, Chris. I'd like to flip to the business side of the equation, and I think we're covering the topics very well, very thoroughly, so I'm not concerned that we're not hitting the details of some of the questions we had laid out for you, because you're doing it for us. Thank you.
Telling us to be briefer?
No. I mean, you keep covering the good information. I keep dropping questions. How's that? From the business side, a combined question. What types of work experience do you offer to our local high school, community college, and college students, such as paid, unpaid internships, job shadowing, and mentoring? The second part of the question is, your company offers a wide range of career opportunities. What are you doing to introduce local youth and their parents and teachers to those opportunities? Who wants to start on that one? Bill.
Well, I should premise this by, first of all, I sit on the board of the Workforce Investment Board, and I chair a committee on applied basic skills. And we have a tremendous team of both representatives from manufacturing as well as from education. And Sharon Dwyer and Peggy Velarde are being very, very involved with trying to address these issues about what we're doing on the education side. So we do have, within my subcommittee, people sitting at the same table. For the last 2 years, we've been trying to crack this nut, if you will. And I'm glad to say that in Ventura County, we're really blessed. We have a fantastic team here. And we're figuring out how to do this and we are the model for the state of California. The Workforce Investment Board of Ventura County is the model where the state wants to go. We're very, very fortunate. Now, having said that, one of my committee members operates a company in Simi Valley that does contract electronic assembly. And they're constantly looking for new hires. And he said recently, my problem now is that I've got recent high school graduates that don't know how to use a ruler to measure the wire to cut to go into the assembly. Now that's kind of one of those, Houston, we have a problem here. And Peggy said, well, that's because the state standards stopped teaching the use of a ruler in third grade. That's a problem. And we have people that they're not equipped to almost deal with reality. So having said that, we've got all these things in place. Now, what do we do about that? My own company, we do take on interns. We've got two junior college level interns with us. In the past, we've taken high school students on. Because of workman comp rules, we have to employ them. And generally, they make an instant contribution. You know, either they're doing menial work, or if they've got the aptitude, we let them take on more complicated tasks. And you know, myself, I do guest lecture occasionally at the college level. I've been at Cal State Channel Islands, and one of my colleagues has lectured at Cal LU. And we know that when we go into those classrooms and talk to these students, they're absolutely engaged with us. And probably we spend twice as much time responding to questions as we do to actually talking to them. So, I mean, there really is a thirst for that connection to industry. And I think really the question for all of you out there, that if you don't learn how to engage with this growing system or this growing collaboration, that you know, this is not going to move forward. But my experience has been very, very rewarding. And I've met not only very, you know, inspiring youth, but I think we've made a huge impact on where they're going in their life. So if you haven't attempted to do this in your business, please consider it, because it is absolutely imperative, you know, everything we're talking about here. And lastly, one thing I'd like to mention, some time ago, I've got a representative from Ventura College in the Industrial Technology Program in my committee, and an occasional visitor from the Biotechnology Program at Moorpark, which is actually one of the most respected programs in the country. And I said, well, I work in medical device industry. So pharmaceuticals has got a focus on making drugs and having production equipment to do that. They also share a lot with the device industry. They work in a regulated environment. They're in clean rooms, they have to learn how to work for procedures, there's quality assurance. On the industrial technology side, they know how to work with the transformation of materials, work with computerized equipment. And I said out loud one day, I said, boy, wouldn't it be great if you guys could take a few classes from Ventura College and a few classes from Moorpark and combine them into a certificate program. It's immediately relevant to me. You know, and I've got my fingers crossed, because this is no additional curriculum required. This is just utilizing what's already been taught. You know, kids in this county drive all over the place, so, you know, they can go to, or adults, they can go to Ventura for some classes and Moorpark for others, and I think we're gonna pull that off. I've got my fingers crossed. Great. One of the trade associations that I participate with, we just work very, very hard to get $2 million for LA Valley College to develop a duplicate of the Moorpark program and the medical device program as well. So that'll serve the eastern end of San Fernando Valley. That took industry participation to get that to happen. So if you don't participate, don't complain.
Thank you, Bill. Other business perspectives? Henry?
Well, I operate in a portion of the private sector that's undergone the sort of change that the personal computer business, the retail business, maybe auto manufacturing have undergone in the last 4 or 5 years. In the print media business, it's not that unusual to find a regional daily newspaper whose workforce is down 40 to 50% over the last decade, and there's this massive transition going on to the digital world, which nobody really has a good revenue model for, which is why the parent company of the LA Times has been in bankruptcy, I don't know, for a long, long, long time, and the parent company of the Denver Post, my alma mater, has been in bankruptcy twice, and so on and so on. Happily, the Business Times is independently owned. We don't finance with debt. We're doing pretty well. But for the individuals employed in the media industry, and this is a big industry across the country, and it's an industry where the U.S. has been a leader. All you have to do is remember last night and all the different channels and media venues and information channels that are available to you, and you can see how important it is. And I would argue for Chris and Dick and others in education, it's important for our democracy. The media is a constitutionally protected part of our society. So what does that mean? Well, for people coming into our industry, the career ladders are broken. And I think this will happen more, not less, in the future. So somebody could come to work for me, go to work for the Star, then go to work for the LA Times. Pretty classic career ladder. Job security at my shop today is probably higher than at either of those two, and that has taken the career ladder and flipped it upside down. So the other thing that's happened is that we used to be able to hire, or we used to like to hire, generalists, people with just a bachelor's degree and maybe a little bit of experience on their high school or college newspaper, and train them as financial journalists. Today, we get our pick of people from around the country or from the region who are experts at their field. And even on the business side of the company, we occasionally find a superstar in our backyard, Veronica Kuzmuk, who's a CSUCI graduate, who's holding down the biggest share of our advertising sales operation, is with us today. I give her a shout out. And what she's got are amazingly good communication skills. So we can go around the country and find those skills, so the competition for our jobs is very high. What would help us...
One more thing, Henry, just...
Yeah. Okay, what would really help us, and I know I've gone on a bit here, but would be for us to bridge the gap with these large numbers of kids who are out of school and can't find jobs, or recent graduates, and a big barrier to doing that are the California work rules, which make partially paid internships really complicated. If we offer people, theoretically, so much as a Starbucks gift card, we have a lot more liability than if we just say, thank you very much for your service. And work rules and working through this transition from school to career is a big problem. And maybe we can carve out a demonstration zone for the Central Coast or something, so we don't have to deal with so much regulation.
Thanks, Henry. Just to keep everybody up to speed in terms of what our program timing is right now, I want to get two more answers from any of the business folks, if there are any more inputs on the business side. I want to take a very quick break and come back. Now, the break was a controversial discussion. We put this together because we don't want to lose people. We don't have a lot of time, so it's going to be a very, very quick one. But hold in for another couple minutes. And I'm also going to ask our panel members to try to, we're starting to drift a little bit in terms of being longer, and I would like to, at this point, you know, cut us a little shorter in terms of some of this. We are covering it very well, and I think we're going to be in good shape toward the end. But break in a few minutes. Bill.
My turn?
Yes.
Great. Agerman has been very committed to education, partly because I believe that I wouldn't have the opportunity I've had today without education. So I do a lot of mentoring to younger adults, young children, to help them be inspired and have a passion to find their way. So Agerman today does a lot of programs where we tour K through 12 through our facilities to show them how the recycling process works, to engage them in what we're doing. We also do a lot of community garden programs where we're constantly donating product to the K through 12 schools so we can teach them how to grow their own food, to help them understand that by learning this skill, they become a little bit more independent. We also, even at the community college level, with Sharon Dwyer, worked very diligently on putting a sustainability program together for business with the community college district to train businesses and students on what sustainability is and how to use it. We've worked very closely with Channel Islands and Cal Lutheran on sustainability and agriculture. Recently, we're very involved in Cal Lutheran's MBA on sustainability and looking forward to that program. We donate a lot of money through sponsorship to Green School Awards so that kids are engaged again in the whole sustainability efforts. The opportunities that we offer that we have today, we have done internships at the high school level where kids come on board and they learn how to become mechanics, they learn how to drive equipment. There is an age issue there with insurance, as it was mentioned earlier, that we work through with the education system. But we also get a lot of young high school graduates that don't know what they want to do. And the one thing that I find with almost every young man that we hire is they are all afraid to fail. Somewhere along the way, they thought that failing was a really bad thing. And while I was in the Marine Corps for 10 years, it's 10 years of planned failure and a lot of repetition so that you can survive when you go to battle. They do a very good job of making sure every possible failure you can have, you get tested on it. And then they make you do it over and over and over again so that when it comes time for the challenge, you don't fail. So when these young people come to work for me, I force them to fail. I say, jump in the tractor, let's go. Don't know how to use it. Well, you're going to figure it out. There's the wheel, there's a gas pedal, try not to hit something. So they get it.
There are no OSHA people in the room, I presume.
They've been there. But it's under planned failure. And what ends up happening is they start to gain confidence in themselves. We live in a world today where we have to compete internationally. I just looked up on my iPad. In 1812, there was only 850 million people in the world. 100 years ago, there was only 1.6 billion. Today, there's 7 billion competitors. The kids that we get today don't know how to compete. They lack confidence to compete. We can train them to do things. It helps if they can read and write and do math. That's very important. But skilled competitors is what Agrimen is trying to do in mentoring these young kids today.
Great. Thanks, Bill. Gary, any last comments before we take a break?
I'll be brief. We have a lecture series. We go to high schools, various health professionals, and two high schools. We orient them in their 11th and 12th grade. We have hospital tours where interested people come through. We have a junior volunteer program where a little over 100 young people come to the hospital in various areas. They're typically interested in healthcare careers. We then have a scholarship program where about 4 to 6 of them who are wanting to go on to healthcare programs. So we orient them that way. Post high school, we have a lot of programs. We provide the clinical experience for nurses, for respiratory therapists, for radiation technologists, physical therapists, nurse practitioners, all the rest. We have a special program for young people interested in pre-medicine. College students come during the summer where there's a program. We have medical student rotations during the summer with USC and Western University. And then we have a postgraduate medical education program for residents in orthopedics, general surgery, internal medicine, family medicine. And so we're very engaged, and it's a symbiotic relationship. So.
Great. Thank you very much, Gary. We're going to do something you typically don't see at a gathering like this. We're going to start at 10:30, whether anybody's here or not. You have 10 minutes. I'd like the panel to take a quick break, be back here. We're going to start with a couple mid-session questions just to get the audience involved, so be prepared for that.
Yeah.
Thank
that.
You. 10:30.
I don't know what you're going to do about
seem
that.
Like that one's
Hi, this is Bill Frank reporting for KADY-TV, and we are at the Visita partnership in education between business and educators here in Ventura County. We're at the halfway point, just summarizing the first half. We have a panel of eight, four educators and four business people, expressing the needs that the business community has of educators and that educators have of the business community. A lot of good points were made in the first portion of this seminar, talking about the various needs. A couple of things to highlight through that. Chris Kimball from Cal Lutheran University brought up some very interesting points about global competitiveness, as did Bill Camarillo. Also, Henry Dubaroff from the Pacific Coast Business Times was talking about work rules and regulations. That was also reiterated by Bill Camarillo. Probably the most important point that was brought up that had been overlooked by previous panel members was Dick Rush, who is the president of Cal State University Channel Islands, talked about civic responsibility. It is the responsibility of educators to have an educated electorate that can go out and can certainly vote. And so he brought that up. The question, of course, we'd have the day after an election is, how does one measure that responsibility? If you take a look at the number of voters 18 to 24, which is the prime demographic for a university like Cal State Lutheran, you'll see that between 2008 and 2012, the 18 to 24-year-old voters were down compared year over year. So we wonder about the responsibility and how civic responsibility is measured there. Coming up in the second half, we'll have continuation of the discussion by all the panel members and comments to the Seth Godin film that was there. Most of the participants looked at that, found it amusing and entertaining, but were somewhat skeptical of it, and each one of them, to a person, defended the position of their organization as to why the status quo needs to be maintained, claiming that we are on currently a solid path to the future. It'll be very interesting in the second half to see if the moderator or if any of the panel members contest that particular theory. This is Bill Frank reporting for KADY-TV at the VECITA Partnerships Between Business and Education Symposium.
Statements, but that are seeking clarity and a little furtherance of what was discussed. So does anyone in the audience right now have a question dealing with the material we've covered so far?
Great to see you.
I have one here.
Did you just decide to? Somebody?
Is there a microphone? Yell it out and I'll repeat the question if you got it.
You're just following it around.
Okay, that's good.
I like the idea of audience participation.
Hello. I've heard a lot about what the colleges and universities and K through 12 folks have been doing to address a lot of career to work path kind of things. And even Bill Pratt was talking a little bit about needing to have people that come in and can do some manufacturing. Bill talked about having people that can come in and maybe drive a front loader. I didn't hear anything at all in addressing the fact that who is school for? Not everybody's supposed to go to college. Not every college is not for everybody. And so when I grew up, we had shop class. We had things we touched. And Bill Pratt alluded to that. You have people coming in, don't know what a Phillips head screwdriver is. We got to have people that can go and do work. What are we doing to address that? There's a stigma. Unless if you're not going to college, there's a stigma. In Europe, they have a vibrant apprenticeship program where you actually want to do something like that. What are we doing to address that?
Okay, and we don't have time for everybody to address it, but somebody has a clear, concise answer in terms of how to deal with that issue of everyone is not necessarily going to college, the skills.
Sure, one thing that we've found at the Workforce Investment Board, as we've been exploring this, Saddleback College, in conjunction with UC Irvine, has a very, very exciting rapid manufacturing program that's about 2 years in action now. And their focus is on modularity and stackability so that people can come out of the workforce, get educational modules that will fit in with their work schedule, and then jump back out, take that skill, either do better at their current job or get a new job. And then if they go back a year or two later and get another module, that contributes to building up to an AA degree. And I think that's a real important model for us to look
okay.
at.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that?
Stacy? I have an answer here.
We need a question. We need a question.
It's an answer to a question. That one. No?
Okay. We'll go.
Quickly.
Go. Get her done.
Good morning. My name is Gabe Samaki, and I'm the superintendent of the Oxnard Union High School District. And a lot of the conversations this morning is really insightful, and I appreciate everyone being here. And I realize that from higher ed, we have representatives in the business community. But I truly believe that part of the issues and problems that we're having in education really have to be dealt with at the high school level. And I'd like to see us have more conversations about how we can engage in partnerships. To specifically answer that question, in the Oxnard Union High School District, we are really focusing on a concept of linked learning, really connecting what we are teaching in the classroom to career and college, but also that we really want to develop partnership with every person in here about how we can prepare students for career and college ready. Just in this past year, this is my second year as a superintendent, we've had amazing growth this past year in terms of our academic performance index. And what we're trying to do is make sure that our kids are not just ready for college, but also for the business sector and the careers. And I think that part of the problems we're having right now truly is funding. That's one of the critical areas. The reason why the shop classes have gone away is because the kind of skills that students are needing for the workforce are not the same kind of skills you really had in shop. Now, I realize the comment was made, well, we're not teaching kids how to use a ruler. But recognize that we are living in a different world today, and what the expectations are for college and what the expectations are for business leaders is a lot different than 1950. And so a lot of people talk about what we should have had back, or what we should have today is our programs we had before in our educational system in the 60s. And I think what we have to do is prepare our students with 21st century skills. And the 21st century skills means that when you come in the classroom, you're not sleepwalking. You're actually using your brain, and you're able to problem solve and critical think. And so the kind of skills we have to get our kids ready for is much different than the classes that you and I attended back in high school. So we are redesigning the high school experience for the 21st century learner, and that's our vision in the Oxnard Union High School District.
Great, thanks, Superintendent. Any more questions at this point? We'll have more at the end. We have time for the end when we finish. Okay, let's make that segue, because there's a couple questions around, or statements around partnerships, and we started touching on it, but let me call out this question here. The policy playbook developed in May 2012 California Economic Summit in Santa Clara reported that the top workforce priority at almost all regional forums surveyed was the idea of creating partnerships among local workforce investment boards, community colleges, economic development associations, the business community, and labor to address such problems as the shortage of skilled workers for certain desirable industries. We've been talking about that, but that seems to be across the board now, it sounds like. So get a little more specifically into it. What specifically should each partnership accomplish, focusing on the partnership? What are the primary barriers to doing so? And what specific ways, if any, could your organization contribute to the development and effectiveness of such regional partnerships? I think we've been hitting on those, but let's see if we can pull that part together. Who wants to go first? Dick.
As I mentioned before, we're all in this together. We cannot survive effectively without each other. The jobs that are available today, most of them did not exist 5 years ago. And so the training that people had to go into jobs 5 years ago today, as you know better than I, no longer may be viable. And as a result, I would suggest that one of the things that we need to do, and I'm certain that Jamila has already thought about this, is that we need short-term certificate programs. So when the skills change and technology changes, you can call upon us as your partner to make sure that your workforce is brought right up to speed in 21st century terms. Unless we stay close to each other on this and you let us know what it is you need so that we can provide it for you quickly and effectively, nobody will prosper in the 21st century.
Jamel.
I'll add to that and also get back at, I think, the question that was asked earlier, and that is that, you know, ways in which we are approaching that is, once again, through career technical education. It is true that college is not for everyone, but we are putting together some of our business partnerships with actual needs. An example is, you know, we have a dental technology program, and while making teeth may not be sexy for some people, it is actually a skill set and a job. And so we're providing that opportunity in some of the community colleges throughout the state, and students come through and get a certificate. It's a 24-month program, but they're going right into a job. We also have other types of partnerships where we will have an industry that will come to us and say, we have a need because there's a shortage. There's a shortage of individuals who want to go into the insurance industry. And getting into the insurance industry is not as easy as most people would think because you have to pass a state exam. And so we've been working with some of those organizations, State Farm, Farmers Insurance, to set up a program designed to fulfill that need. So what we work best with is working in partnership to try to address the need of what seems to be lacking or where there's a skill set that there just doesn't seem to be enough people that have it. And that's where you community colleges are extremely unique. Our economic workforce development, which is synonymous with career technical education, is we can establish the career based upon what the need is in that community, working with that business industry. And so those are some of the things that we try to work to do to match up those needs, but also in getting individuals to work.
Gary and then Henry.
Many years ago, there was a council as part of it, may still exist, I don't know, called the Regional Health Occupational Resource Center. We met in Santa Barbara City College, and representatives from all the community college, from Hancock College to the north, all the way down through College of the Canyons to the southeast, we met on a monthly or every other month basis. There were hospital administrators, there were pharmacists, there were others there, and together we forecast what the need was going to be for careers in the healthcare fields. We then looked at resources, and there was not a need for every community college to have a nursing program or a rad tech program, but we made sure that the region, we try to balance out and find funding through Sacramento or locally so that we could produce the number of people skilled in those jobs and a commitment that they'd be able to fulfill those jobs. There was also a commitment to help train in the clinical environment. If that type of model worked for healthcare, and I think it did, it may be also a model for other industries, manufacturing, or even the service industry, but business and educators getting together on a regional basis, including the four-year colleges and the community colleges, because I think that's where really the rubber hits the road. What is the demand? Where's the funding? And then to gear educational programs for young people that they can meet and then go into the workforce.
Before I get to Henry and Chris, there's just one thought that's come up a couple times, and I want to interject it as we're talking, is that it seems like there is a lot going on in the business community, and being part of the business community, I'm somewhat amazed that there really are programs going, and one of the questions is, what do we need to do as a business community to communicate that, not to pat ourselves on the back, but to show that there are models, there are ways to effectively build on people's success to broaden those type of programs. And so as we're talking about this in the business community, I'd like to have us, you know, also talk about what we can do to get our good work that we're doing here in our own companies out to the other rest of the world in the business community. Henry.
Well, we can help you communicate those ideas.
Was that a setup or what? But
thank you, Stacy.
Anytime. You've had a free commercial already, so this is the second one.
I'll take my media hat off, and I won't ask for any more free time, but I'll speak as a small employer. We have 12 full-time people at our company, or FTE equivalents, I guess you'd say. The HR department is really me and our employment lawyer. And so as we think about partnerships, you know, it's pretty easy to create a complex partnership for a large employer who has an HR department where there's a lot of ability to deal with overhead. For us, it's really a question of cost and accessibility. Tax credits, for example, which are things that large employers can take advantage of, we used one of the largest CPAs in the region, and we had an opportunity to use targeted jobs tax credit. I had to explain to our CPA what that was. So, you know, making the paperwork simple and making it easy for small employers to take advantage of these programs is really key. And the payoff is huge because, as we all know, companies with 25 typically or fewer employees really are the ones that create 60 to 70% on net of new jobs in California, Central Coast, U.S. So that's my plea. I think the Germans have a better idea in a way because they actually subsidize some of this training. So they're willing to write checks to employers who participate in these partnerships. The idea of that happening in California is so far-fetched, I hardly bring it up.
We'll wait for your next editorial on that one.
There you go. Okay, thanks.
Stacy.
Chris and then Bill.
Quick comment. The quote you read reveals part of the problem. The only education sector mentioned in that plethora of groups coming together was community colleges. And as long as the state only looks to one sector to do it, it's not going to get done, because while everybody doesn't need to go to college, there are plenty who do need 2 and 4 year and advanced degrees in a whole range of areas, whether it's engineering, allied health, digital media. That's not going to go away. What we don't pay enough attention to, however, is all the people who start and don't finish, whether it's a degree or a certificate. How much wasted talent is there that's left incomplete? And that's one of the shocking realities of American education in general. And if we did more to speed people through the pipeline wherever they come out employable, but to make sure they do finish with something rather than being left incomplete, not employable at the level that they started to prepare for.
Yeah. One thing I'd like to mention about that, we know in the industrial technology area at Ventura College, for example, that students get hired out of the program before they finish. So be patient with those statistics. That's very common in career technical education, that we're so desperate for talent that we'll take people before they've got everything fully rounded out. Forming business trade associations is fundamentally important in your area. As we heard about in healthcare, in the life sciences, the Southern California Biomedical Council, of which I sit on the board and chair a workforce committee there, in the last 5 years, we've helped obtain $2.4 million of funding for Pasadena City College and for LA Valley College. And the grant for Pasadena College was in support of the blood products divisions of Baxter and Grifols. Grifols acquired Green Cross. They're spending $1.5 billion revamping that facility, and they're in the midst of hiring 500 people. And Pasadena College will do the training of those people. So that's that type of partnership that we're looking for. But if you don't form the trade association to be that interface, to be that advocate, to help line up that funding and what have you, there's a piece missing. In Ventura County, we've recognized that, and this year we formed the Manufacturers Roundtable to get that type of discussion going. And it's a nascent group. Haas Automation has been incredibly supportive, and I hope to see that grow. So that's focused on the manufacturing sector. If you work in other areas, please pull yourselves together. Perhaps Visita can play that type of a role as well.
And Gary, yours, the medical side was really the wider industry, wasn't it? The broader industry that represented the industry that helped too. So that's
right. The leadership came from the educational sector, but there was a broad group of healthcare professionals that came together for it.
The trade group. Okay, great. Bill.
Just a quick comment about the partnerships. Partnerships are a two-way street. And as a business community, we can continue to tell you what we need in the way of a workforce and a skilled workforce. But when we look at the education system, it is a brain trust that's in our community. And as a chair of ACETA, one of the things that I worked on for Ventura County as a whole was to better understand the industry sectors that worked and lived here. So using the university as a research or information source, information is power, and it allows us to be more competitive as businesses. So if you want business to thrive and expand in Ventura County and other parts of the state, I think on the second part of the street, we need to
figure out a better way to get information back from the universities on what's going on out there in the market space, because it's so large today. We don't just compete in California anymore. We're competing nationally and internationally, and we need information to allow.
What kind of information are you thinking about, Bill?
Market information, technology, anything that can give us an advantage over our competitors. And with that allows our companies to grow. And when our companies grow, we're able to hire people. And then connected together, we're better able to understand how to train them. The sustainability program that Cal Lutheran put together that I was involved in a little bit with is understanding how to use that training. When we work with companies like Sony Pictures, I go read their sustainability report so I can understand their policies, so I can better figure out how to help them and create a job. So by creating that job, I'm able to hire people that understand what their goals are. So being able to get information back either through a research center at the university in each industry category is pretty important. That's the two-way street I'm talking about.
Okay, anything more on the partnership thing? Stan.
At the break, you know, I was hearing comments both from educators and business people about, wow, this is great, you know, I'm learning a lot. And that leads me to ask the so what question, what will we all do when we leave here today? And it gets at one of the barriers. One of the barriers is just simply a lack of awareness and persistent awareness in visiting our schools. You know, only 20% of the population, maybe less, even have kids in school. And our image is probably a lot like what it was when we went to school. So I would ask the business community and in turn the education community to reach out to one another and to visit a school and do it at your local level with a local school district superintendent. Make the inquiry. They'd be happy to show off, believe me. And then you can tell them a little bit more about what you want and what you need so that we don't think we only need to train phlebotomists. In addition to that, you help us increase the value of our product. We can't increase the cost of it, but you can help us increase the value of it by being there and being there with us. And when there is a lack of awareness, the relationship's not as strong and the trust factor's not as great. But when trust is high, things move quicker and things are done more cost effectively. So I think we need to go away from this place thinking about what we've learned and doing something about it.
Anyone have one follow-up? Thank you, Stan, before we move.
Very quick comment. Right now, at the Ventura County level, the county CEO is proposing an economic development or economic strategy component to the county's general plan. That likely will involve identifying industry clusters, and that's a great place for business and education to come together to start to communicate about ways forward to develop workforce and job opportunity.
Okay, and we're going to come back to how to put this together and close it out, but there's one or two other loose ends that are floating around, and we haven't really hit them, I think, directly. One of them is really one of the education questions that we had lined up, and that is education seems to be focused on our state's low national ranking on various test scores. Why is that so important at the end of the day, or is it? I'm looking at educators, but I'll take anybody who...
I'll kick it off, and I'm sure there will be more astute comments to follow. But, you know, we're always looking for ways to measure things. If you can't measure it, how do you improve it? Mm-hmm. And as I referenced before, I think the systems are flawed. I think that the direction we're going with standardized tests puts a blanket on entrepreneurship and creativity. And the speaker that Chris Kimball recently referenced has a very compelling graph about what happens to those nations that are focused on how well they do on standardized tests versus the line that goes in the other direction that stifles their creativity. That's something America is known for. And I think we need to get away from that, which is why we're pursuing 21st century learning, which is more self-directed and teaches people more about thinking and thinking out of the box than memorizing things in that old factory system that we're used to.
Well, do we have a way? I mean, because I heard two things is this whole election cycle. One is the test scores and one is the low dollars. And is there a substitute that is more enlightened in the long lines you're talking about that can really get us to measure what it is we really want to measure as opposed to some of the means to get to that endpoint?
Yeah. In our world, and I referenced this before, we're going to be looking at a new assessment system for students that's going to be in alignment with the Common Core standards.
Okay.
And it's going to be difficult, and it's going to be difficult to do it in the timeline that the state is requiring of us to do it. But what it will do is it'll give us more up-to-the-minute information on how a student's doing. And better yet, in alignment with something that Saul Khan does with his academy, is letting the students know how they're doing. Isn't that a novel concept? For them to be able to see how well they're progressing point by point at each point in time.
Okay, Jamil.
There are two things that I think I have to point out, but first of all, let me just, I don't know if he's still here, congratulate my Board of Trustee member, Bernardo Perez, who was elected last night to our board. I don't know if he's here, but if he is,
he was here. I just said hello to him a minute ago.
Okay. There are two things that are taking place at the statewide level and at the federal level, and that is that, you know, in community colleges, we need a level of consistency because assessment tests are different at every campus and different within the same district. You know, what you take at Ventura as an assessment may be different than what you take at Moore Park or Oxnard. And so the state has now asked for a level of consistency, and the statewide chancellor's office is right now looking at, similar to what K through 12 and Common Core, we're now looking at consistent types of assessments because individuals and organizations and the government want to measure how we're doing. And it's all about your evaluative component and how you show your success. Now, coupled with that, what's happening at the federal level is that, you know, The Obama administration has started with the graduation initiative and asked for completion and outcomes. Because what they're wanting to look at is, if all of this money is going to education, how do you begin to track or how do we look at your success? And they want to look at our success based upon outcomes. And outcomes are looking at either completion or what I think is the other spectrum is performance-based funding because of limited resources. So the challenge for us is that we have different things are happening at the state level, different things are happening at the federal level, but trying to create that level of consistency so that you can at least be able to identify to the average taxpayer who's not in the educational world is, if what I take at Oxnard College going to be the same as what I take at Ventura and Moore Park, and can I go to any business in Ventura County and get the same outcome? So I think in order to get at your question is consistency in how we are measuring one another so that we can get the same level of outcome.
I hate to ask this question, but I need to. The K through 12 Common Core that Stan talks about and the college level performance level that you're talking about, are they going to be compatible? Are they going to be consistent? Or are these started out of two different shops and going to come up different?
No, they're not going to be the same. It's job security. We can't work together completely. You know, no,
I was afraid of the answer.
It is our holy grail.
I guess I got my answer.
Stacy?
Yes, Dick.
Many of you know my favorite philosopher is Yogi Berra. And you remember the story of when he was going to a dinner one night and Phil Rizzuto was driving the car and Rizzuto said, "Yogi, we're lost." And Yogi said, "Yes, but we're making good time." We are committed, as my colleagues are, to assessment, trying to figure out whether we are achieving what we think we are achieving and ought to be achieving. But there's one other element I would ask of everybody in this room. If we are not producing the kind of employees and the kind of research that you need, you must tell us, because that really is the fundamental assessment. If what we're turning out is not working, you've got to let us know. That feedback loop has to be finished. Otherwise, we're going to continue driving with Yogi somewhere into the night.
Is there a mechanism to do that, Dick, that you're aware of or that you'd recommend, as opposed to just catching the parking lot and say, "Hey, Dick, it's working or it's not working"?
Yeah, I try not to hang out in parking lots much, Stacy. But
we've met there a couple of times, I know.
There are feedback loops. We have, as I mentioned earlier, groups for all of our programs. You can feed through them. Or failing that, just call me and I'll put you in touch with the appropriate vehicle in our institution that will enable us to get your feedback. But it's not just individual. We need the feedback from your firms. If we're not producing the kinds of employees that you want, whether it's your HR department or your president or whoever, you must feed it back to us, because that's the ultimate assessment for us.
Chris, and then Bill.
We're fortunate in not being beholden to the state for performance measures, though we are to our regional accreditor, and we could fill and do fill a room about this size with documentation showing that we're doing what we claim we do. I think there are a couple of sort of high-level measures that the public wants to know about that are going to be increasingly important. Those are, how fast does it take someone to get through your program? Do they graduate on time? Let's say they graduate in May. How many by September are working in a field of their choice full time? And increasingly, the question will be, perhaps more on the independent side of the house, how much indebtedness did the students take on to complete that degree in that time? And we as a sector are going to be held to those measures, and I think those come to echo Dick's point, much more about preparing citizens and employees for you than questions about test scores on standardized achievement tests.
Let me continue my one question here a little bit based on what Chris was talking about, the Common Core and the college level performance and the private institution performance. Is there any cut across those lines there? Has the government come to you, or have you gone to the government in terms of some of those things that you're doing that they're working on now for the state level?
I would be kind of a smart aleck and say try to stay away from going to the government. it is true that for independent higher education, the amount of government regulation of what we do is far beyond anything that's ever existed before, and I've been told repeatedly by some of our advisors that the one bipartisan consensus in Washington is that private higher education needs to be more regulated. I'm all for bipartisan consensus, but that didn't seem to be the right place to do it. Obviously, because our sector does very well at completion rates, getting students to graduation, and we do very well at job placement rates, we'd love to have those kinds of measures used as an assessment tool for how well we're doing. The kinds of things that show up in the U.S. News report that unfortunately many families still look at are all about inputs and often really correlate to how wealthy the students are that come to you and how wealthy the institution is. They don't tell you a thing about what's accomplished while there for 2 or 4 years or whatever the time may be. And I haven't seen anything coming out of Washington really aiming at those fundamental issues.
Sure. Bill, let's wrap up the performance question here.
One of the things we've talked about, if you kids go through or young adults get a certificate, if the HR departments are not listing that as a job requirement or at least a desired attribute, there's not a market for that certificate program. In California, we don't really have a lot of industrial certificate programs common in our junior college system or adult school system. It's more common back east, and that's something that we're pursuing here. But if the HR departments don't ask for it, then people aren't going to pursue it. And I'd extend that to say if HR departments didn't ask for a four-year degree, there'd be a lot less interest in getting a four-year degree. So it kind of creates a market for it. And I really like volunteering other people to do to follow up on my ideas. And I think there's a great opportunity here for the LaCaio Institute and CLU and the business school to look at a research project in outcomes in healthcare. And it might become a surprise for you in the U.S. In the device industry, we really don't do outcome studies, long-term studies. So if I put a product on the market, let's say it's a hip joint replacement, chances are in this country, nobody's going to look at my long-term results 10 to 15 years out, unlike in Scandinavia, where they actually do great detail track individual devices for the long term.
And that's so socialized medicine too, isn't it?
Absolutely. And they get rid of the bad stuff real fast because they can see the trend. So unless you've got a research project that is tracking individuals 5 to 10 years out from their last point of contact with the education system, you really don't know what you're doing. You get all this sort of anecdotal stuff like me sitting up here saying my applicants just, you know, don't have what it takes to get my job, you know, and that's 15 years too late. So we really don't have an intelligence gathering system for that kind of long-term feedback on how the education system's doing. And it's a great opportunity for you and a great opportunity to locally collaborate on something like that.
I think we have a segue here in terms of this next question. Higher education faces the twin prospects of decreased public financial support and increased government regulation in a number of areas, all of which adds to the cost of delivering the educational programs. How can business help? How feasible is it to ask business to do things like getting directly involved in influencing the government direction or being more involved in the institutions themselves? What kind of responses do you have to that? Does the question make sense?
Well, we need you, because when we talk to legislators, they say, sure, here he comes, whether it's Jamila or Chris or I doing it at higher education, they say, yeah, they're coming in, they've got their hands out, their vested interests. But when the business community goes to legislators and says, we need change, we need support, we need education to be made one of the priorities of the state of California. I apologize in advance, but I have a hobby horse. Proposition 30, whether you liked it or not, in my mind was the head of a pin. How did we, in this great state, get to the point where that proposition was going to determine the fate of the future of California? How did we let ourselves get there? How did we not step forward as a community, as a society, and say, the state of California needs to establish its priorities and you elected officials must do it or get out of the way and we'll put somebody there who will?
Yay!
I mean, this election yesterday is just the beginning. If Sacramento, in our state, does not take up this challenge of establishing direction and priorities, we're going to be back 4 years hence having some other stupid proposition that is replacing the authority and responsibility we put in Sacramento and is not being utilized. We can't keep doing this or we're going to fall apart. So in my mind, and I again apologize because I feel very deeply about this, the business community needs to carry higher education's water, because the elected officials will listen to you because they're saying higher education is the servant of the business community. In my mind, we are here to broker opportunities. That's what we're here for. We're not competitors. CI does not compete with Cal Lutheran. We don't compete with the community colleges. We're here to work together to benefit you and the individuals that you entrust to us to be educated. But we need you as our full partners carrying that water.
All right, let's Stan, and then we'll go to Jamila.
Okay, I realize the orientation here is toward higher education, but I'd like to expand the frame a little bit, if I may, feeling a little bit like chopped liver. many of us serve, and the reference was made to the P16 Council, which stands for preschool through the four-year university level of education. It's probably bigger than that. You know, admittedly, early education, and you all have heard or should have heard about the importance of making an investment at that level. But I think it's got to be done all the way along, because we can't wait for our kids to get to higher education for that business investment. We've got to have that business investment all the way along. And in those of you who are successful in your businesses realize you are so probably because you treat your people really well. And you care about them, and you care about their families, and you care about whether their families have preschool, and they don't have to worry about what their kids are doing while they're working for you. That's very important. And then if you want to expand the frame a little bit bigger and answer the question that the presenter in the video didn't answer, what is school for? School's for life. How many of you are athletes in school? And that training kept you doing workouts, hopefully, to this day, in greater or lesser form. But that's training for life, and that's lifelong learning. That's what you're doing here today. And that's not a cost. That's an investment. And whether it's in preschool or university and graduate studies, it's not, it's your R&D. And even in bad times, companies invest in R&D.
Jamal.
I have to apologize as well, because I don't want to be a buzzkill, but I don't know how many of you are familiar with the ability to benefit ATB.
Sounds like not many from the looks of the...
Yeah. Ability to benefit is a test that you can take if you don't have a high school diploma and you want to go to college. If you have decided to wait for whatever reason, you didn't get a high school diploma in a traditional sense. At the congressional level, at the federal level, Congress did away with the ability to benefit July 1 of 2012. And what that means for all of us up here when you talk about business and education is when you're trying to look for the skilled worker, I think the other challenge we have is we have just knocked out a whole category of folks to access. So if you don't have a high school diploma, you can no longer have access to education or additional skill sets because the ability to benefit tests doesn't exist. You don't even make it down there to Chris or Dick. You're right, you can't even get in my door. And so what that means is that you have to go to Stan to an adult education program. Well, you may be fortunate if you're in a county that still has adult education program that will help you get a high school diploma, because some counties have already canceled them. So we have a whole cadre of folks that don't have access, but they want to work and they want that opportunity. So Ventura, at least for now, is okay. They do have access to some adult education programs, but you can probably guess who has signed up to offer adult education in the sense of a high school diploma. It's proprietary schools online. And so that's a whole nother cadre of looking for the skilled worker. Are they getting that skill set from a credible source? And we have a whole population of folks, because of the ability to benefit, going away, not having access to college education because they can't even get a high school diploma. So that's another cadre we have to add into the mix that really requires us to have open lines of communication and working with our K-12 partners that talks about the importance of the P16 Council, because many individuals are not even aware until they show up at a community college wanting to go to school because they don't have a high school diploma, or they show up and try to get into an adult education program that's been closed.
You're right, that was kind of a downer. Thanks for letting us know, though. Chris.
Obviously, for Cal Lutheran, we're a little bit different. The question about dwindling resources from the state government, it affects us. We have students who are in need who rely on Cal grants. The teachers produced at our Graduate School of Education need to have school jobs to go into. So we're affected too, but not as dramatically. And I would certainly underscore what Dick has said about needing a tight relationship with the business community, including us listening. But I would also ask for those of you that are in private business to help bring to our policymakers, and forgive me, Henry, the media, some of the same discipline that you use. For example, a small example, the word costs gets used all the time and people are not clear what they're talking about. Here, the costs of education, the costs of higher education, meaning how much tuition, or I guess the fees or whatever California requires one to say. They're going up X percent and so forth. What should also be asked is, what is the cost of providing the education for which people are being asked to pay some portion? At our place, like at yours, there are subsidies, whether it's from the state and taxpayers, in our case, from donors. Very few people are paying the full cost of the education that they're getting. That question doesn't come up, and it needs to. And I would say to the business community, and this is going to sound as more of a challenge than I mean it, if you look and say, okay, the costs of providing that education are worthwhile, you have labor contracts that are sustainable, whatever it might be, and the education you're providing is good, then we'd call on you to invest in it. If, on the other hand, our costs of provision of education are too high, tell us where we can do better. And if we're failing to deliver the product, which has been one of the themes today, we need to hear that, as Dick has said on several occasions. But we need to look at it the way you look at your businesses. And again, forgive me, Henry, it seems to me the media in particular throws out terms and we hear about the cost of higher education and it bears no connection to what it actually costs to do what people are expecting us to do.
Before we move to questions from the audience, is there anything else quickly? Yes, Bill.
I'm sorry.
Bill Camarillo and then Bill Platt.
I've kind of been sitting here dormant. Almost forgot what the question was.
Okay, I can tell you what the question. How can business help? How feasible is this business to
I kind of know where we got, and my shoulders are feeling a little heavy because, you know, businesses in the environment that we're in today, we don't spend money for things we don't need. And because the economy is so challenged today and we've been in this long-term, slow growth, no growth environment, we believe in investing in the future and our children today because we know they are our future. But we need workers, okay? We believe that our children today can be trained with skills to work. What we lack are workers. When a 49-year-old guy can outwork a 20-year-old, I have a problem. They get tired. They don't want to stay. They want to go home. They just don't have the energy.
The passion.
And you know, they're football players. And I'm like, wow. You know, how is that possible? You know, when we didn't have automation like the Harrisons did, they picked up trash cans every day and do that for a whole day. And so today they have automation. They get tired driving in a truck with a joystick. So
I think it went video games.
We know we have a great education system, and we know they can be trained. Where did we lose the life skills along the way that Stan was talking about? Yeah. How do we get them to have some endurance, some confidence, some staying power, some competitiveness, so that when they do come to the workforce, that we're excited about having them because they aren't going to want to quit? And I think that goes back to having some passion, being inspired, because when you have passion and you're inspired, you lose time. You forget what time it was. You're not looking at the clock. When you're allowed to fail and you learn from that failure, you come up stronger. So I think that in the partnership that I'm talking about, it is a two-way street. We are happy to do what we do best, to lobby our legislators, but most of the time we're doing it to survive. They create regulations faster than I can read them. And as we try to navigate through this environment that we're in today and be successful at the same time and hire people along the way, most of the time I'm just looking at the new hires is this person going to work? Then what kind of skills do you have? So I'm glad that we had this conference today. From the business sector and the business community and VECTA, we are ears wide open, and we will communicate back to the education system, because I think if we don't find a better way of talking back and forth, we're not together going to be very competitive in the world, and that's what I'm concerned about.
And we have a comment from Bill Pratt, and then we'll move to a couple audience questions. Bill.
I was fortunate to attend the Gold Team get together at Amgen when the Lieutenant Governor was here and Jeff, and the thing that I posed to them, it wasn't talking about the economic burden of education, it was talking about competitive advantage. And when you frame that conversation to elected officials about falling behind in our competitive advantage, then they put on their football team hat and say, wow, we don't want to fall behind, we got to jump in there and do something about it. So if you frame the conversation, because everybody else in the world is going to school on us, and they're getting better at it. Mexico is now graduating the same number of engineers and engineering technicians as the U.S. Well, that's a big number, and I kudos to the Mexicans, you know, especially with all the challenges that they have. But if we don't invest in this, we're going to fall behind. We are falling behind, and it's all a matter of competition, because there's lots of people in the world that want to compete with us, and they're going to school on our game, and they're going to win.
Thanks, Bill.
Hi, this is Bill Frank reporting for KADY-TV at the VECTA
symposium on business and education. We're just wrapping up with questions and answers from the audience. During the presentation, we heard from educators and business members about what is needed in Ventura County to create a closer bond between business and education. Some of the interesting points that were brought up were the ideas of civic responsibility, that education is preparing citizens to fulfill their role here in society. More interesting than that, I think, were some of the talks about global competitiveness and the costs of education as well. Following this, there will be some recommendations by the panel on what business and the educators can do together to make things better in the county. We've heard a lot from the educators who brought up very interesting points about global competitiveness, cooperation that needs to be done, as well as a little reported fact of the dropout rate on that. So we will talk more about that, I'm sure, in days to come when we get the report that comes out. Interestingly, absent from this group was government and the role that government plays in education in terms of pure research with regulations and work rules, as well as global competitiveness. And that may be a subject for future Visita and symposiums that they put on. So for KADY-TV, this is Bill Frank reporting.